Bueno, pues creo que de los que estamos en estos momentos presentes, la presentación, valga la redundancia, sale sobrando. Ya conocemos a Francisco Romero. Francisco Romero es originario de Sonora, pero ahora mismo vive en los Estados Unidos. Estudió su preparación universitaria en Arizona, es egresado de la Universidad de Arizona. Y su trabajo dentro del béisbol, hasta donde sé, pues lo ha desarrollado con los Rojos de Cincinnati, los Cerveceros de Milwaukee, los Mellizos de Minnesota, y actualmente presta sus servicios para los Astros de Houston, que junto con Alex Treviño, José Cruz y el mismo Francisco son las voces oficiales en español de los Astros, ¿no? Sean todos ustedes bienvenidos y cedo la palabra a Francisco para la conducción de esta charla.
Gracias, Héctor. Sí, so Héctor just introduced myself as an employee of the Houston Astros, a little bit of what I've done in the past. Vamos a empezar con Sig McDowell. Vamos a dejar que nos hable un poquito de él y luego empezamos con lo que es la entrevista que le vamos a hacer. Sig, well, welcome to this group, first of all. They were very eager to hear about, they've heard a lot about you through me and the great things that I tell them about you, but in short, tell us, who is Sig McDowell?
Well, that's an easy question. I think I'm here because I got real lucky. I've been interested in baseball statistics since I was a kid and happened to join the industry at the right time, at a time when it was changing. And so the opportunities were very large. The inefficiencies were large, and I happened to work with persons who were not shy in taking advantage of it. And when I look back, it's so much as luck. So I think I'm lucky.
First of all, tell us what is sabermetrics? What is analytics? What is it?
Yeah.
Pues sí, que es las estadísticas de análisis, que es la cibermetría.
Analytics is simply looking for insights in data. And that is relevant in the baseball world because persons with different backgrounds have come in and they're looking at the data that exists, but there's also new technologies which is creating additional data. And so analytics is just taking a look at that data to see if there's anything useful. Francisco, when you think of, right, like a high-speed video, that is revealing things that the human being simply cannot see. You could see whether the ring finger is the last finger to come off the ball on a changeup and what that means. And the radar devices are revealing spin rate and movement to an accuracy that we just simply can't see. So it's, I guess you could call it a tool. It's really an extension of our senses, our capability, sort of like a telescope, right? It opens up a whole new world.
Okay, so in regards to this, overall you put it together and you come out with decisions, not only in-game decisions, but also you use it for player development and for other things within the game?
Yeah, I think anytime a human being is taking information from the world, from the visual senses, and trying to make sense of it, they rely on their experience, their memory, some mental math, and they come up with like a decision related to it. And there's few things as well recorded as what goes on the baseball field. And so I would argue anytime that the human being is making these types of decisions and you have this wealth of data, it certainly can't hurt to examine that data to see if we're missing anything. Not on that, Francisco, right? If human beings were perfect, if we had perfect vision and perfect memory, and based on our lifetime of experiences, we made perfect connections between cause and effect, we wouldn't need any of this. And so as long as we're willing to admit that we're not perfect, we this has to be an advantage. This has to help us if the, you know, if the analysis is done properly, whether that's for a coach developing a player, for a scouting director evaluating a player, or for a, I would argue, for a manager determining whether it's good to bring the infield in or not, or send the runner on contact, or when to go to the bullpen. That all these things that we do with our brain and our experience and our gut, they're not perfect. Not because we're lazy or we're unintelligent. They're not perfect because we're human beings. And this could help sort of put bumpers or a guide rail and bring us back when we start doing something that feels right but isn't right.
Most of us rely or our basic understanding is what we see in a major league baseball game. In some decision makings, like the defensive shift or taking a pitcher too early or too late. But I want you to explain a little bit about what you did with the Cardinals and with the Astros and what you're doing with the Orioles in regards to the development of players going back to, I don't know how far, if you go to the, even to the Dominican League or is that where you start or in the U.S., but I'm very interested from what I've heard from you before about the use of analytics in development of players.
Okay. So in St. Louis, it was very little with the development of players. I was involved in the draft. And so you could imagine the majority of the draft is college players. And they played college for 3 years, usually two summer leagues. And you have a whole bunch of data on how they've done. But if you didn't have persons in the front office who were sort of skilled with data and adjusting for the easy parts, the easy leagues, you could just dismiss that data and say, this is no use. Were making its way through all the parks. So many of the hypotheses that pitching coaches had, you know, keep the fastball low, you know, throw the changeup in fastball counts, pitch to contact with your two-seamer, whatever. There's a ton of these beliefs from their experience and their expertise. And many were right, but some were just a little off, some were a lot off. And the analysis with the radar enabled us to see what convention was sort of off on. And again, with the culture and the coaches, we were able to take advantage of that. And so we had a sort of a game plan. Every time the pitcher threw, there was a specific thing he was trying to do better. And we had the feedback. You could see the RPMs to within 10. You could see the movement to within a quarter of an inch. And so they were constantly being nudged and developed in a way that we had the confidence was towards what was going to succeed at the major league level and not necessarily what this pitching coach thought would succeed at the major league level.
Was that what you did with Colin McHugh? Is he a good example of your practice?
Yeah, so Colin McHugh was a player who we could look at his pitches and what pitches were expected to work against what handedness and in what location. And we then looked at what pitches he was throwing to what handedness and to what location, and there was a disconnect. So we thought there was an opportunity, if he was willing, to bring him in and say, hey, here's what we see. You might want to throw this more to this type of hitter, and you might want to throw it in this area. And that, along with his work ethic and an improvement in other areas that we simply weren't expecting, and then you had this guy who was on waivers become a consistent starter for the Astros.
19 games he won that year.
Yeah.
And now another example. So you are just a little bit of Colin Verlander. Am I correct on that too?
Yeah. So the hard part isn't really doing the math and doing the analysis. The hard part is changing the culture where you have experienced persons willing to rethink how they've been doing things. Because you could imagine, like, you are a baseball person. You take tremendous pride in this. And what you've been attaching your name to year after year, like, it might not be perfect. And human beings are funny in that way. Sometimes they dig their heels in and continue on a path that is not the most efficient. And so the easy part, and I'm sure many other teams have done what we've done, but the hard part was getting coaches and creating a culture to take advantage of that. And that was Jeff Luhnow again in Houston, you know, Brent Strom, you know, the pitching coach for the Astros, and then the players. And then as time went on and more players were doing this, the new players, whether it was Cole or Verlander, would come in and see this. And if they were inclined to push back, I think they were a little bit less inclined when they saw that guy and that guy and that guy all taking advantage of it.
So in essence, one thing is you give them the information, but the player has to buy into it. The coach has to buy into it. Then they got to go into practice and perfect it. Am I correct?
Yeah, and that's the surprising hard part, is to get a coach to buy into it, or a decision maker, a scouting director or a manager to buy into it. Because by definition, what we're selling is sort of counterintuitive. If it felt right, he already would have been doing it. And so what we're selling is somebody like myself, who's not of his fraternity, trying to get him to do something that doesn't feel right, when nobody is tenured here. Like, people's careers, their heads roll every few years. And so it's really difficult to do that.
Two things that I'd like to get into. One is, we didn't discuss this yesterday, but I want you to talk about it. We talk a lot about analytics and numbers, and sometimes players say they feel like numbers. But you went to the minor leagues, you put on a uniform, and instead of being a number, you became a player. You felt what it was like to hold the bat, fungo, to go on the trips, eat with the guys. What was it like? I don't know if to call it an experiment or what, but you felt the human part of a baseball player.
Yeah, that, from a personal standpoint, which doesn't really benefit the Astros when I did it, like it was a wonderful experience. It was something I never thought I would be putting on a uniform and coaching first base in a professional baseball game, right? Like this was, I don't know, like a crazy dream. So that was wonderful. But from the Astros standpoint, right? Well, like we're all passionate about baseball. You can imagine our lunch hours are talking about all sorts of crazy ideas, but we don't really know what it's like in the minor leagues. We don't know the time constraints, like the physical constraints. Like you don't know until you experience it. And so part of it was to go brainstorm and see like how we can improve, but really to learn what the life is like. And like you said, I learned so much, but also appreciate like how the players or the coaches get attached to the players and how you can't help but root for them. And just the wonderful experience and reasons why coaches like coaching. It was wonderful.
That's a great exercise you guys did. I want to call it an exercise, but it was great. One thing in the minors, the World Series in 2017 ended the Game 7 with the piggyback system and pitching. It's something that you, probably the Astros or I think you started with the Cardinals doing this, but you did it more, I think, you correct me if I'm wrong, more with the Astros. Maybe it's only one of the many things that you did that we don't know about, but it was very exciting for me as a broadcaster to learn about it and to see it finish that way. Tell us a little bit, el sistema de piggyback, the papuchi and the trisando.
Yeah.
Tell me a little bit about that.
So there were, it came about, I think, from two considerations. One is the realization, of course, that starting pitchers are much more valuable than relievers. And once you move a starter to the bullpen, it's really rare in development that he ever returns to being a starter. It's sort of casting you to the bullpen once and for all. And if you think of that, and then you also have a realization that we're not as good as we think in knowing which of these pitchers are going to be the best 3 or 4 or 5 years from now. And so with those two things in mind, we wanted to keep as many pitchers in the mix to be a starting pitcher as possible. And some of them would surprise us and take a step up in velocity or control or develop another pitch or two. And these were guys that would have been put to the bullpen. They would have been happy with two pitches and so-so control, and that sort of would have been them. But this was a way of keeping them, you know, keeping more guys in the mix for being a starting pitcher.
So that was it was great. And then the World Series ended up that way using the piggyback system. Sig, before we get into the topic of the Snell issue, what have I missed? What do you want to add about what analytics is and maybe what we see as fans and not as baseball people? What do we miss here? What do you want to add to this conversation?
Yeah, I mean, I think that analytics is nothing more than what the human being is trying to do in his head, right? You take in this information, you identify relationships, you know, if I do X, then Y happens. If I have this pitcher hold the ball this way, then this happens. And analytics is the same thing, except in doing it, instead of doing it in your head, we're doing it in a spreadsheet or on a computer. And secondly, I say that the most difficult part is getting the coaches or the decision makers to buy into it. And that was, I don't know, 90% of the effort was trying to convince an expert that there's still room for improvement. And to turn the mirror on yourself and to be willing to say, okay, I may not be doing everything perfect. You know, let me know. Let me see And that really is sometimes a rare attribute of a person, that the search, even when you're an expert, to get better. And that's the beauty of the coaches we hired in Houston and now in Baltimore too. These guys, although they're truly experts, they're searching for improvements all the time.
And I like to call it, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, sometimes you're under the law of probability with everything that you take into consideration.
Yeah, right. Like it's human nature to, if you have a good result, it's human nature to assume it was a good decision that led to that result, and vice versa. Like if I were to ask you, what are your best decisions in the last year? You're probably going to tell me what were the best results, not necessarily your best decisions.
Hey, see, I have Brent Strom on the line right here. Brent, I'm talking to Sig right now, so I'll call you right back.
Hey, Stromy.
Okay, yeah, Stromy just hung up.
And so I think, right, that human nature leads us to make connections that aren't always so. And so our decision-making and our understanding of the world is not completely perfect. Like we have sort of this causal mind, if A, then B. But the real world isn't that way. It's if A, then a chance of B, a chance of C, a chance of D, a chance of E. And so like the Snell decision, right? Like everybody has great, I knew this was going to come up. Everybody has great confidence that this was a bad decision. Like everybody's gut tells you that, but that's clearly because it was a bad result. But imagine if the bullpen shuts him down, nobody's talking about this. But it doesn't mean it was a good decision, obviously, with a bad result. But it does, I think it is worthwhile to evaluate how you determine a decision is good or not. And simply looking at the result in one case, like no reasonable person thinks that's what makes a good decision or a bad decision.
And so you sent me some information about it, and you know, you did some research on it. So how do we tell the people who have a very limited, like maybe me, understanding of this, and you know, like somebody who throws in the glass of soda or something, being mad because the result wasn't good?
Yeah. So I think, right, everybody here is baseball literate, is quite smart in the baseball world. So when it comes to this decision, I think we all could conjure up, we all could think of the pros and the cons of keeping him in or out. And I always think, you know, like the scales of justice, where you put weight on one, and that the decision is sort of that. And it's either going to say keep him in or take him out. And so we know Snell is a really good pitcher, right? So there's some evidence. Let's keep in a really good pitcher. So we're putting some weight on that side. And he's not only a good pitcher, he's a pitcher that was pitching really well for those first, was it five innings?
Yeah.
So I'm guessing he's not just the normal Snell, he's an improved Snell, a better version of Snell. So there's some more evidence that we put there. But we also know he was facing batters for an additional time through the order. And we know that they're a little bit better at timing up his fastball. They're a little bit more comfortable. And so there's some evidence, maybe we don't want him in. But then the next three batters had all struck out against them. So there's some evidence, like we do want him in. But then Tampa Bay has the best defense or the best bullpen in baseball. So there's some more evidence. And I'm sure you guys could think of others. And we would all nod our head in complete agreement that all of these things are correct. But now comes our brain and the mental math and how important each of these things are and whether the scales tip this way or the scales tip that way. And I don't know which way the scales tip. I haven't done all this math, but like neither has anybody else on this call. So I feel insecure saying whether it was a good decision or not. I do know that, at least for me, there's something surprising when you look at how very good pitchers have done after they've pitched a very good five innings. In our mind, we sort of think, okay, I'm expecting a sixth inning to be like the first five. You know, maybe he gives up a chances of a run or increased or something. Like that's, I think, what we think of. And when we put the weight on Snell is pitching well, it may be bigger than real life suggests. Because when you look at those pitchers, how they do in the next inning is surprisingly close to how they do in general. And I wouldn't have thought that. I bet few of you would have thought that. But when you look in real life, that's what happens. And so you could either go, nah, I don't believe that. This guy was on. Or you could go, maybe my model of how the sixth inning works is a little bit different than I thought. And I know Tampa Bay has done this, and Cash is no dummy. So I don't know. That they pulled him out, and that they have more info than us, and that he's really motivated to win, makes me think it wasn't clearly a dumb decision. Now, it clearly had a bad result, but I don't know if it was a bad decision.
Good, good. I don't know if you want to add anything, but with that, we can start. You give us a pretty good understanding of what it is overall. Muchachos, si tienen ustedes alguna pregunta para abrir esto, to open up for questions for Sig, ya pasaron media hora, que algo que ustedes quieran preguntar. So we'll leave it, we're going to have some questions, Sig.
Okay.
Maybe Sig, I would like to have the whole picture of you. If you call analytics, what at least I saw in some of the games, that there were some formulas before the game started, some formulas that did not came inning by inning through the with the continuity of the game. It was a formula that was before. I never will put Snell for the third time they go to bat against him. I will ask you, there is analytics that will tell you inning by inning how to react to those new situations. There are only 73 lanzamientos, how do you say it?
Pitches.
73 pitches. Yeah. Only the sixth inning, he was really throwing well. He was struck out, as you told us. The last two guys, the guy that came to relieve is not particularly good against right-handed hitters. All those situations is the possibility to adjust and not go to the big formula. We will never bat against the, right. The three times. Sorry.
Yeah, I understand the question, Juan. So I think if you're going into a game and you have a rule that says, take out my starting pitcher 100% of the time, the third time through the order, like something has gone wrong. Like that's not analytics. That's bad analytics. But I think if you are able to share with the manager different percentages, different expectations, what we sort of call it like the base rate, the general conditions. And he has an understanding of that. And now he experiences not the general conditions, but very specific conditions that you never could have modeled beforehand. That if you have a manager who understands basic conditions, and then has the mind to make adjustments, like that's all good. Sure. not, and I can't believe that.
Yeah, it's a hope not.
That would be like a really bad idea.
Debemos de suponer que ellos vienen de un proceso de aprendizaje a lo largo de su organización. Ahorita que mencionó a Fernando Valenzuela, que suponíamos que 5 innings eran perfectos para Fernando, ¿qué tan difícil es convencer a un pitcher en que cambie su mecánica de acuerdo a la observación estadística? Sabemos que, por ejemplo, el screwball es una pichada que lastima mucho los brazos. Incluso el cambio también es una pichada que lastima mucho los brazos. ¿Cómo observan ellos este seguimiento en cada pitcher conforme, obviamente, también lo que se mencionó de Verlander, que es muy difícil que un pitcher ya maduro cambie su manera de pensar en hacer cosas diferentes, porque así se lo está diciendo el análisis estadístico? ¿Qué tan difícil es convencer a los coaches para que ellos, a su vez, platiquen con sus pitchers en tratar de hacer algo que les va a dar mejores resultados, pero que, en cierta forma, le pudiera lastimar su brazo?
In your experience, Sig, how hard, well, we know that the pitchers, the players come through a system of development when they get to the majors, especially the starters, and they're taught a certain way. But like, for instance, Fernando Valenzuela threw the screwball, and it hurts the arm. And we all knew that 5 innings would have been good for Fernando for every start. But other pitchers who throw a changeup also, or other pitchers that hurt their arm, how difficult has it been in your experience for a pitcher, starting pitcher, or a coach to change? You mentioned Verlander a few minutes ago, but to change their approach to pitching, showing them the data that will make them better if they change, whether their mechanics or their style, whatever it is they have to change to make them better. How difficult or how easy has it been in your experience for coaches and starting pitchers to understand that?
Yeah. So regarding players, this is maybe obvious, but it's really easy for the minor leaguers. Like the kids right out of college, they show up, they're wide-eyed, this is pro ball, you have this additional technology, you have these charts, you have this plan. It's very few that really push back. And as they progress, they don't push back. They get more and more confidence in this, like a Lance McCullers or a Joe Musgrove. Like, they went through our system with this, and they're believers of it when they make the major leagues. Now, before there was the Verlander and Cole, we tried it with other major leaguers, and there wasn't an interest in a general sense. There was much more reluctance. It was a different time than it is now. Now there's more of an acceptance, like maybe the success the Astros have had, but also what the Rays are doing, what the Yankees are doing, that the players talk and there's more of an acceptance, as opposed to what's this strange analytics stuff that, you know, I'm not used to. I'm in the major leagues. Why do I need to change? So that's the part of changing the culture and building your own. And now, if you have the major leagues and the majority of pitchers are from your own system and they're doing it, and you have a coach who's supportive of it, now when Verlander and Cole come, it's just a different world. You're not asking them to do something strange. They're seeing what all these other people are doing and the success they're having, and they're more open to it. But it was difficult when nobody else was doing it and there were no anecdotes of success to talk to. It's really hard to ask somebody to do something that they're not completely comfortable with or doesn't seem intuitively the right thing to do. It's really difficult. But I know it won't work if you're just hoping an analyst changes the guy or one coach. You need the message from the owner, from the GM, from the director of player development, from the manager, all with the same expectation that this is an opportunity, right? Like, this is an opportunity that's in your best interest. You can get better if you don't push back on this. You could be, you know, cynical and question it and conservative, but you can't like dig your heels in and just say, this is not for me. And that's why I say I'm lucky. Like, it wasn't, I didn't talk people into this. Like, it was a culture change from up top that I just happened to be the analyst in the middle of it. And unless I own a team or I'm the GM, like, it's so hard to really nudge people to reconsider without the support of everybody above them.
Okay. ¿Entiendo bien, Antonio?
Sí, muchas gracias. Thank you very much.
Okay. Una pregunta, Tocayo, y sí, ¿qué tanto la sabermetría de analytics está sustituyendo el factor humano, el coraje de un lanzador, de un pitcher, de seguir adelante? Por ejemplo, tomando el caso de Snell que mencionaba hace unos minutos, pues él quería seguir, ¿no? Y la de Analytics le dice que pues, se va a enfrentar al orden de abad por tercera vez, que después de la quinta entrada no es efectivo, etcétera, etcétera. Pero el pitcher tiene la bravura, como la tuvo Randy Johnson para pedir la buena en el noveno juego después de haber tirado el sexto en la Serie Mundial de 2001, o Nolan Ryan, que se decía que no... Bueno, a ningún pitcher le gusta que lo saquen, ¿no? Pero él decía, a mí no me saquen, el juego es mío. ¿Qué tanto mi pregunta es, ¿de qué manera se puede medir que la de Analytics, la sabermetría, está reemplazando ese factor humano del coraje de un pitcher o un bateador?
Okay, the question is, how much of is analytics taking away from the grit, the courage, the passion of someone pitching in the moment and having that courage to go out there and like, at one time, Nolan Ryan did it, and Randy Johnson did it in Game 7 after pitching Game 6. So is analytics replacing that passion, that fire that a pitcher has while in the game?
No. I mean, I think in relation to the game or the development or the coaching of players, it's really just an extension of their senses. It makes your eyes better, and it makes your brain, your ability to make connections better. And then once the coach has that realization, he's still giving instruction to the pitchers just like he was. He's still trying to get them as psyched up as he can. They're still fighting the adrenaline. It's just they have a better understanding of this player's weaknesses or the strengths and weaknesses of their pitches. But I think it's... Like, if you had a bad coach, he's going to be coaching that Nolan Ryan differently than the good coach. The analytics just enables this coach to be a little bit better and give the right instructions to Colin McHugh, right? When you're facing all these lefties, you might not want to throw your two-seamer low in the zone like these other coaches have been telling you. Like, this next pitch and this pitch might be better. Now go get them. Right, it's just, I think, in the quality of the instruction could be improved, and you're just giving a bit better instruction. But I think once the game starts and all that, they have to execute, and the passion and determination and ability to function under pressure, that all still exists. It's just your coach is a little bit better, and the pitcher understands a little bit better his strengths and weaknesses, I would argue.
Thank you very much.
¿Alguien más? And I guess one thing that I would like to stress, and I stress it a lot, Sig, is the human element, el elemento humano. I think you stated it in some of your answers. It just goes back to the human element. For instance, in that game that the Dodgers lost, on the error on the outfield, and then the throw to the catcher, that game had everything pointed. Even that play had everything pointed to the Dodgers winning that game. But the human element, you know, was that error, and then the throw was a little bit open. So the human element in there still reigned over what we thought was going to happen.
Yeah, I don't know how to answer, but yeah, like obviously the outcome of the game is all still the same. We're just trying to educate the coaches and the players and the managers a little bit more. Like, so the human element on how a person develops his in-game strategy is not the most sophisticated, right? Like, I think of a major league example. When the opposition has the infield in, there's a runner on third, one out. There are some major league managers which will send the runner on contact 100.0% of the time, including Albert Pujols, the slowest guy in baseball. They're giving the green light. They're sending him on contact. While there's other managers who'll do it 0% of the time. And these are both smart people. They both know the object of baseball, and they're not coming up with something that's a little bit different. You know, this guy does it 55%, this guy does it 60%. Maybe it was the circumstances. They couldn't be further apart, 100% and 0%. And like, they can't both be right. But it's sort of taboo still to sort of question, like, this baseball expert, like, you know, and to try to suggest, like, let's figure out who's more right than not. And are you interested in this manager? And so it's hard to find a manager. But that's, I think that's the human element that we're trying to that we're battling against to make better decisions. But once that decision, that green light is given, everything is the same. It's just sort of in the margins that these decisions are different.
Very good. ¿Alguien más tiene pregunta para Juan Carlos?
Sí, y muy rápido porque es mi segunda y quiero dar oportunidad. No, me da miedo. I'm afraid, Sig, that time will run off and without asking you something for me very, very important. Mexico, Mexican baseball.
Yeah.
We have not the cameras, all the technology that Major League Baseball has, but we need to go to sabermetrics, to analytics. We've been trying to do something, at least here in Guadalajara, without success. What will you recommend for Mexican baseball without the technology that you have in major leagues, but in order to implement at least the first steps with this new tool that for us is very necessary, but at the same time, we do not have enough technology to back it up.
Yeah. I mean, so often the changes or the innovations come from like outside of baseball. Like Moneyball was written by an outsider. The changes, Sandy Alderson was an outsider. Paul DePodesta was an outsider. And so often if you're waiting for the change to come internally, that just doesn't happen. They're very comfortable in the way they're doing things. They have an expertise in the way that things are going. It's a really rare that a person says, okay, let's question my expertise and let me look elsewhere for something that's going to contradict what my value is. But I don't know the state of, you know, Mexican baseball and analytics, but I know they have to be as competitive as anybody. And I would think the owners or the GMs who have the budget, one will have seen and heard of like what's going on in the US, and for no other reason than financial benefit, bueno, said we need to take advantage of this opportunity, but it's going to take an infrastructure investment too. You can't just, you know, hang up a TrackMan device and give the data to the current coaches. You're going to need an analyst and a good analyst to make sense of it. You're going to need a culture change where they're encouraged to rethink their expertise and take advantage of it. You're going to need like what we started 9 years ago in Houston. So it's going to take time, but my guess is that the competitive forces that exist and the financial rewards will be nudging Mexican baseball and every other baseball towards this. It just, you can't put it off forever.
Thank you. Thank you, Sig.
¿Alguien más preguntas para Sig?
¿Yo puedo hacer una pregunta? ¿Puedo hacer una pregunta?
Claro, claro que sí.
¿Me escuchan?
Sí.
¿Me escuchan?
Adelante.
Adelante, Julio.
Bueno.
Sí.
No sé si me escuchan.
Sí.
Yeah. Quiero hacer una pregunta, a ver, es en relación a ver si me doy a entender perfectamente. Sabemos que los resultados, por ejemplo, ahora en la Serie Mundial, en el último juego cambiaron a Hall, en donde supuestamente, entre comillas, por los resultados de la cibermetría, pues lo cambiaron. Mi pregunta va relacionada a este dato es, ¿el pitcher que entra estudió al bateador que está ahí y la decisión del manager está basada en que es el óptimo para sustituir a ese pitcher que está en turno? ¿Está basada por visceral o porque se basa también en la cibermetría?
The question he's asking is, going back to the World Series and the pitching change in Team 7, was it, are the pitching changes just based on the scouting of the pitcher and batter coming up, or is it also based on analytics, as we've been talking about?
Yeah. It's a combo of both. Admittedly, in the recent years, it's more and more analytically based. And so, right, like, I don't know, like, if you had to describe the strengths and weaknesses of a particular hitter, you could look at some video and you could look at his swing and you could come up with some conclusions, and that works to some degree. An alternative way is, let me look at every pitch he's seen in the last year or 2 or 3 years, categorize it by the horizontal movement, the vertical movement, the velocity, and really find out what pitches, in what areas, in what counts this player succeeds and struggles with. And then let me look at our current pitcher and what movement and spin he has and how this particular player has done against pitches like that, and to less degree pitches somewhat like that, and to a tiny degree pitches that are arm's distance of that. And let me quantify that and let me illustrate it to the pitcher and the catcher and the pitching coach automatically with no effort from anybody. And so you got that on one hand, and you'll have the reports on the other hand, and now you could synthesize it. But I would argue when that coach is looking at video, he's going, oh man, that was a bad swing on that fastball up. You know, oh, but it was 0-2. You know, maybe it's not so smart to throw that fastball up if it's 3-1. Look, he missed, you know, he chased that changeup on two strikes. But the pitcher throws 98. You know, I don't know if that's going to work on 92. A Ken Giles slider is a lot different than a Joe Smith slider, but they're still called sliders. You know, Eshelman's fastball is 88. Aroldis Chapman's is 106, but they're both called four-seamers. So it's a difficult task, and a human being will do something with the amount of time he has to some degree, but to think that that's the best way and that this data-driven way that looks at every characteristic is of no use, I think, is missing out on an opportunity. Now, certainly hitters change their approach, and the model is not going to know that, but at least having a human being that knows the model, and then with the situation that he's seeing, he's able to throttle up or throttle down is ideal. And I think that's what we want. We want a really smart decision maker, and we want to send him what the basic expectation is, and then let him deviate as he sees fit.
Te la traduzco, Julio, ¿la entendiste? ¿Sí la entendiste? Okay, perfecto. Sí, we come up to an hour.
Okay.
I think this gentleman would like to talk to you a lot more. Héctor, Juan Carlos, llegamos a la hora que Sig nos prometió. We're going to end it here. We're going to respect your time, Sig. Anything you want to add?
Yeah, let me add like one more thing. So I just saw this tweet. So I bet none of us remember the Game 6 decision in the 2017 World Series that A.J. Hinch had. Like, sixth inning, does anybody remember? Like, we're not talking about it. But Justin Verlander had thrown 69 pitches. That's the same amount Blake Snell had. He had struck out eight Dodgers, had walked one. The Astros were ahead 1-0. So that's the same thing. Snell had struck out 9, walked 1. The Rays were ahead 1-0. And A.J. Hinch kept Verlander in for the sixth inning. He gave up 3 runs. So just like the bullpen in Tampa Bay did. And so I think that's like the probabilistic world we're in. Like, we're talking about the Snell because it didn't work, but we're not talking about the Verlander thing because it didn't work. And so we're all grappling. Like, I don't know what the right answer is, but I'm a little skeptical that what my stomach tells me is going to give me the right answer on this.
I would like you, I think you have to go, but the next manager on the guy in the field, do you think it's going to be like Roberts of the Dodgers? Like, I see here more of a nanny, of a guy that takes care of the character of the people, but do not make the decisions on the field, at least my idea, or will be the manager that really takes the decisions one by one and goes with the game without consulting, always upstairs?
Yeah, I mean, I think, and I'm biased, but I love A.J. Hinch. A.J. Hinch was, I mean, is a baseball guy. He has the respect of the players. There was no problem there, but he also has the mind and the lack of ego to understand where he could use help, and the desire to work with an analyst to prepare himself, to know what the chances are of you know, bringing the infield in if the leadoff hitter hits a triple? Like, should you do that or not? Or do you send that runner on contact? Like, we had it in game 7 of the World Series with Brian McCann on third, who's got to be, he may rival Pujols in a foot race. And now you need to decide whether you're going to send him on contact with one out or not. Like, this is a tremendously important decision. Do you want somebody making that decision because, I don't know, when he was in high school, his coach told him this is what you need to do? Or do you want somebody who's searching for the right probability on that? And so I want the guy who has the box checked, that he's going to have the respect, he can motivate the players, he has that baseball knowledge, but also is willing and able to, you know, follow the math on whether it makes sense to send McCann or to bring in the infield, or is just willing to discuss the Snell Verlander pull the pitcher out in game 6 of the World Series thing.
Hey, so what happened with McCann? Did he go or not?
He was sent on contact, and like so many times you swear he was dead if the second baseman threw it home, but he looks, and then just the loss aversion thing, turns to first and throws it to first.
I remember that. Okay, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, Sig, this has been so enlightening. I thought every time I talk to you, it's just amazing. So thanks for taking the time, too.
No, it's my pleasure, and it's nice to see all you guys, and thank you very much for asking for me to join. I'm very privileged with that.
Juan Carlos, thank you very much.
Gracias.
Mucho gusto. Gracias.
Hasta luego.
Gracias. Thank you very
gracias.
Much.
Gracias.
Un saludo a todos.
Hola, Cornelio. Un saludo, Cornelio. Bueno, thank you so much.
Está Cornelio, hitting coach of the Naranjeros.
Gracias. Adiós.
Y por gracias. Cierto, me quedo con una duda a los que saben. Sigue habló mucho de sabermetría hacia los lanzadores, pero habló poco de los bateadores. ¿Sí te diste cuenta, Cornelio?
Tiene cerrado su micrófono, Cornelio.
Micrófono. No hay manera de decirle, ¿no?
Sí, aquí le pregunté. ¿Sí? Yo. Le puse ask to unmute, pero no lo abierto.
Tienes el micrófono cerrado, Cornelio. Pero la verdad es que sea, ahí está ya.
Así es, tú muy interesante. Está muy interesante, sí, es cierto. Habló mucho de picheo. Yo creo que la sabermetría es especial en el béisbol también, ¿verdad? Yo creo que el béisbol es estadísticas y no lo es todo, por supuesto, ¿no? Pero
lo algunas que cosas
estamos de acuerdo, en algunas otras cosas no, pero pues hay que entender que es el futuro, ¿no? Se ve como que es el futuro de...
Sí. Fíjate, Francisco, ahorita Paco hizo una pregunta en cuanto a la sustitución de esa emoción del pitcher, de ese sentimiento. Hace una hora más o menos en Milenio Televisión entrevistaron a Julio Urías y le preguntaron a Julio ¿qué le había dicho Roberts después de que él lanza el octavo inning? Entonces dice Julio que él sabía que ya había hecho su trabajo y él llegó al dugout y sus compañeros lo empezaron a felicitar porque dice, yo sabía, dice, que allá en el bullpen estaba nuestro cerrador estrella, que es Jensen, y yo sabía que él iba a venir en el noveno inning a tirar el noveno inning. Pero cuando llega él al dugout, después del octavo inning, y lo empiezan a felicitar sus compañeros, le dice Roberts, le preguntaron, ¿qué te dijo Roberts? Le dijo Roberts, no, que todavía no te feliciten, porque vas para el noveno. Entonces, ajá, él se quedó sorprendido, porque dice, ¿cómo me dice eso de que voy para el noveno? Si allá en el bullpen, yo sé que está el cerrador estrella de los Dodgers, ¿no? Entonces, voy con lo que preguntó Paco. Yo creo que ahí Roberts se fue más por el momento que estaba viviendo de ver en la forma que estaba tirando Urías. que hacerle caso a la sabermetría que en un momento dado le hubiera dicho, necesitas cambiarlo y traer tu cerrador.
Pero también ahí, por ejemplo, Urias hace una combinación de pitcher abridor y relevista. Entonces, ajá, te basas en la sabermetría. Te va a decir que su condición la tiene para lanzar tres entradas. Pero es cierto, tienes razón. Lo mismo le pasó a Dusty Baker con Zach Greinke. Vino a sacarlo. Y ¿sabes qué? Lo dejó y lo mismo dijo Zach Greinke. Qué bueno que me diste la confianza porque yo sé que los numeritos indicaban a que me sacaras. Uh-huh. Son cosas
¿eh? Inclusive, en ese juego, el sexto juego, que salió pues Julio Urías, no sé si se fijaron, estaba Kershaw en el bullpen. Cuando terminó el juego, Kershaw no salió del logout, salió a felicitar del bullpen. O sea que lo tenían ahí por si se ofrecía a Clayton Kershaw, que había lanzado el día anterior también.
Y es por eso que los tiene que ser combinación, porque Cornelio nos puede elaborar un poquito más, no puede decirte ni por un lado ni por el otro. Y lo que nos dice Sig es que, no sé si Cornelio puede elaborarnos esto un poquito más, donde la información adicional que te da la cibermetría te sirve para hacer básicamente, no quiero decir mejores decisiones, pero decisiones basadas más en, con más información que la información que tenías antes.
Uh-huh. Sí, eso es correcto. Eso yo creo que sirve bastante. La sabermetría y las estadísticas te ayudan bastante, pero también está al lado el coraje del lado del jugador, ¿no? También
así
el
es. Humano.
Hablábamos ahorita de Urías, y inclusive es muy diferente también un relevo, un abridor, que él estuvo en las dos partes como relevo y ha estado como abridor, pero no como relevo corto. Es otro tipo de adrenalina, ¿no? También muy diferente, ¿no? Entonces, pero bueno, hizo el trabajo, y es lo importante, era el momento importante ahí, y le dieron esa confianza. Muchas veces la sabermetría te ayuda en muchísimas cosas, pero el lado, como dicen, el lado del coraje, el lado humano del jugador, las ganas de ganar también dice mucho, ¿no?
En la última respuesta que le dio a Julio, no sé si se fijaron que estaba hablando de las estadísticas del bateador y sus tendencias, pero nos estaba platicando, bueno, podemos ver los lanzamientos que le han hecho a este bateador desde hace 2 años, lanzamientos horizontales, verticales, y hacerlo match o igualarlo con un pitcher que puedan ir a lanzarle donde más ha fallado el bateador. Pero a lo que me interesó a mí fue que nos estaba hablando de datos, de información de hace 1 año, 2 años del bateador, información que ellos tienen en cada pitcher que ese bateador ha enfrentado. O sea, eso. Obviamente, pues es muy interesante, ¿no? Tener tantos datos sobre un pelotero. Y cuando yo platicaba con él en Astros, siempre me contaba de que el béisbol tiene datos desde hace 100 años, que ellos pueden ver datos de diferentes, Ted Williams, de Babe Ruth, porque los datos es un deporte donde los libros de anotación están ahí, pues, en ocasiones pichada por pichada.
Fíjate que es muy interesante eso. Muchas veces ha pasado pues, en tantos años en el béisbol, que dices tú, por lo regular el bateador derecho pues le batea bien al pitcher zurdo, ¿no? Que eso es una creencia, pero no lo es del todo. Muchas veces dices tú, ¿por qué le dejó el pitcher zurdo a este bateador derecho, que es de poder, y no trajo al pitcher zurdo que tiene el bullpen? Resulta que el bateador ese de poder tiene un porcentaje muy bajo contra zurdos, o específicamente contra ese zurdo. Ahí es donde entran todos los números y las estadísticas y todo eso, ¿no? Y son decisiones que toma el manager ahí basado a eso también, ¿no? Basado a que, o igual muchas veces un pinche zurdo enfrentándose a un bateador zurdo y resulta que el bateo al zurdo ese le batea muy bien al zurdo, ¿no? Y le sacan al zurdo, es el manager, saca al zurdo muchas veces, sin saber que el bateador zurdo ese es muy buen bateador contra zurdo. O sea, y mete un derecho, ¿no?
Pero como lo era, sí. Como lo era,
oye, Cornelio,
como era Rubiel, ¿no?
Oye, Cornelio, la sabermetría en el béisbol mexicano, obviamente, pues no es lo mismo que en Major League Baseball, pero sí ya está, ¿tú sientes que ya está pesando cada vez más?
Claro que sí, sí está dentro, más en la Liga del Pacífico aquí, bueno, nosotros tenemos un manager que cree mucho en eso, está con Oakland y nosotros llevamos muchísimas estadísticas de los jugadores, en mi caso de los bateadores, conteos, todo lo que más ahorita tenemos una junta sobre eso y yo creo que poco a poco se va a ir metiendo más a nuestro béisbol y va a ser de gran ayuda, ¿verdad? Siempre ha habido estadísticas, por supuesto, ¿no? Pero cada vez ahorita hay más y yo creo que van a ser de gran ayuda. No va a ser todo, como siempre yo, es mi forma de pensar, no lo es todo, pero yo creo que sí nos va a ayudar bastante, se ayuda bastante a tener un amplio criterio sobre una decisión, ¿no?
Sí. De hecho, algo importante que ahorita sucedió en esa respuesta es que cómo, y me voy a referir un poquito a los comentaristas, muchas veces ahora vimos de que si ya había enfrentado, por ejemplo, Urías, que lo sacaron en el sexto inning y que ya había enfrentado a ese bateador, y ahorita fue el dato importante, ¿no? Los datos son de 2 años y la gente que estamos viviendo el momento pensamos que fue ayer y el resultado de la cibermetría. Entonces, ¿cómo nos hace falta estudiar a los comentaristas el punto de historia, de saber cómo se ha comportado ese bateador con ese pitcher y poder hablar con más razón? Porque lo que pasó ahorita fue que se criticó mucho al manager, casi nadie lo queríamos, hasta hacíamos cola para correr, lo decía, ¿no? Digo, así hablando un poquito del meme que se dio hacia el público, pero ¿cómo hace falta saber que esa cibermetría no viene de un juego o nada más de esta temporada, ¿no? Sino por lo menos ahorita se están basando como esos 2 años, ¿no? Por lo menos, ¿no? Aunque haya muchos datos anteriores.
Correcto. A la otra, pero, díganme.
Perdón, pero hay una cosa que Cornelio también nos puede apoyar y nos puede orientar en este aspecto. Cornelio, en lo que trabaja, yo creo, con sus peloteros, es precisamente evitar o mejorar los puntos débiles que tiene el pelotero y donde lo están dominando. ¿No es así, Corny?
Así es, mira, es una tremenda pregunta. Eso estaba pensando decirlo. Fíjate qué curioso. Sí, muchas veces el otro equipo está diciendo o hacen un meeting y dicen a fulanito hay que picharle así, así lo hemos sacado, así, así, de diferente forma. Pero también el béisbol es de ajustes. También, por el otro lado, el coach de bateo también le da la información al bateador y le dice, mira, ellos te han sacado así, así, así. Entonces, es de ajustes, pues es de ajustes. Y estás trabajando en esos puntos finos, en esos detalles que, con los que te han sacado out. Exclusivamente, a lo mejor, el equipo ese le gusta tirarte pegado, le gusta tirarte rompientes pegados o te tira muchos cambios. Pero ya el bateador, ya cuando se vuelve a enfrentar, también ya lleva esa información él de que ese equipo le tira así. O sea, ahí estamos hablando con Urías de una información de hace 2 años, pero también el jugador podría verse, se ajusta también, se puede ajustar a eso. Él también está pensando que él lo ha sacado de esa forma. Entonces, él también ya está preparado también para que no le vuelva a pasar, ¿verdad? Yo creo que el béisbol es de ajustes también y ahí están los dos equipos peleando, ¿no? Yo creo que ahí entra el trabajo de cada uno, ¿no? De tanto el pitching coach y del coach de bateo por el otro lado, ¿no?
Mira, ¿Angelos tiene un sabermétrico?
Déjeme darle un ejemplo de lo que habla Cornelio. En la Serie Mundial de Astros contra Nacionales, sacan a Greinke y entra Will Harris, ¿verdad? Entonces metió jonrón Howie Kendrick para irse al frente. ¿Recuerdan ese?
Bueno, sí.
Entonces, y el coach de pitcheo, Brent Strom, que tal vez sea nuestro siguiente invitado, voy a platicar con él, me dice Brent Strom, dice, entra Howie Kendrick, ¿por qué sacamos a Greinke? Porque Howie Kendrick batalla mucho en los lanzamientos en la recta cortada, en el cutter. Creo que tenía, en 181 turnos, tenía dos hits en cutter. Entonces metimos a Will Harris, que es experto en cutters. ¿Ok? Entonces, Will Harris, ¿qué hace? Viene el true cutter y queda muy abajo. Y lo mete y lo saca de jonrón. Pero espérense, días después voy a comer con los coaches de Nacionales, con los coaches acá, y les platiqué esto. Y me dice, ¿sabes qué? Nosotros sabíamos que Will Harris iba a enfrentar a Howie Kendrick. Y a Howie Kendrick le dijimos, ¿sabes qué? Te va a tirar el cutter. Prepárate para el cutter porque Will Harris es de los mejores en tirar cutters. ¿Qué hace? Howie Kendrick se preparó para el cutter. Primer lanzamiento, segundo no recuerdo, y la sacó. Incluso el cutter era muy bueno. Estaba muy abajo el cutter. Era para que le hiciera swing y le abanicara, pero estaba preparado Howie Kendrick para el cutter. Lo mismo que dice Cornelio. Lo escuché de ambos lados y ambos lados hicieron los ajustes, solo que Howie Kendrick salió avante en ese aspecto.
Entonces hay espionaje y contraespionaje dentro del dugout, ¿no? Y por lo que comentaba Cornelio hace un momento, entre si enfrentarse a un bateador zurdo a un zurdo, o a un derecho a un zurdo, etcétera. Me recuerda que en la película Moneyball, Billy Bean uno de los scouts, coaches, le dice, ¿por qué contratas a ese bateador si apenas batió alrededor de 200, ¿no? Pues sí, le contesta, pero fíjate que nuestro estadio en Oakland batió arriba de 300, ¿no? Entonces nos puede ser de gran ayuda. Por lo que me lleva a pensar que cada aspecto de la estadística debe de tener un trato individual, ¿no? ¿Ya? No es una regla que un pitcher zurdo, domine a un bateador zurdo, ¿ya? Porque ahí tenemos a Tony Gwynn, que no tenía respeto por ninguno de ni zurdo ni Cornelio, ¿no? Cornelio o Wade Boggs o Rod Carew, ¿no?
Tengo mejor porcentaje contra zurdos que contra derechos. Ese mismo ejemplo dio Stig al hablar de Colin McHugh, que es de persona a persona. Ahora que está Cornelio aquí, quiero hacerle un comentario que hizo Brent Strom, el coach de picheo de Astros, en una plática. Y pregunta a Brent Strom, él es coach de picheo, y pregunta a los coaches donde está dando la plática. Ahí estaba yo, no soy coach, pero estaba de metiche. Y les pregunta, ¿por qué no hay más zurdos que tiren en velocidades altas, 96, 97, 98 por hora? Mejor, hay... Randy Johnson es una excepción, hay excepciones, Chapman, pero ¿por qué no hay el mismo número de zurdos o el porcentaje tirando velocidad? ¿Tú puedes contestarme esa, Cornelio?
La verdad, bueno, no soy pitching coach, pero es verdad, o sea, casi no hay muchos pitchers con zurdos con esa velocidad. Por lo regular, los pitchers zurdos se caracterizan por tener muy buenos rompientes, ¿no? Pero pocos velocistas, ¿no? Ha habido pocos relevos cortos, por decir, si ha habido grandes ligas. Aquí en México, pues no, la verdad casi la mayoría son sustitucionales y abridores, pero
volviendo a poco de velocistas, de hacer cosas poco ortodoxas. El coach de picheo dijo esto, porque desde niños, ¿a dónde mandamos a los zurdos? ¿A la primera base o a los...
O al jardín derecho.
Sí, dice, a los zurdos tienes que ponerlo de shortstop. Agarra la pelota, guante volteado. Se tiene que plantar y tirar a primera. Usualmente tu mejor niño es el pitcher, el tercero, el shortstop, el catcher, que todo el día están practicando tirar. El primera base la agarra y tira y la devuelve. Entonces, esas cosas poco ortodoxas que nosotros creemos que son leyes en el béisbol, pues de repente nos damos cuenta que si se hacen un poquito diferente, podemos ser más exitosos. Por eso quiero invitar al coach Brent Strom para que nos hable un poquito. Eso no fue de mi idea, fue de un coach de grandes ligas que dijo eso, ¿no? Entonces, a ver si la otra podemos invitar al coach Brent Strom, que incluso ya compró residencia en Puerto Peñasco y quiere empezar a hacer cosas en Sonora y Baja California.
¿Habla español?
Habla poquito español, pero vive en Tucson actualmente, pero le encanta México.
Oye, Cornelio, el picheo mexicano sigue siendo
de puras mentiras, o si ya ves más velocidad, o sigue siendo así de puro, así tiro, tipo lo que era. Bueno, a ti te tocó de las dos también.
Ha mejorado mucho en cuestión de, fíjate, cuestiones de velocidad. Hay muchachos que tienen muy buenos brazos. Sí, ha cambiado en ese aspecto. Ahorita ya hay mucho gimnasio, se trabaja mucho, y no como los tiempos de antes, también igual en Grandes Ligas, ¿no? Si ves, hay muchas técnicas más nuevas y que te hacen que tu velocidad mejore. Aquí también se están implementando, aquí en México también estamos avanzando en eso también, y los jóvenes pues están saliendo muy diferentes también. En el caso, por ejemplo, de los zurdos, pues no se ven, pero sí hemos tenido zurdos también que han tenido buenas velocidades. Yo no creo que tanto sea porque los metes a batear o no, yo creo que a lo mejor son las características de los zurdos, ¿no? Que tienen hasta esa cierta velocidad, no sé, pero ahí vamos a las estadísticas, ¿no? También vamos a eso, no hay muchos zurdos que tengan mucha velocidad tan fuerte, ¿no? Pero por lo regular son bateadores elegantes, si te fijas, un bateador zurdo, pero sí, el picheo mexicano se ha caracterizado en el transcurso de los años por la combinación de picheos. Los pitchers zurdos, los pitchers en México, se dice que tienen muchos picheos rompientes, no como Estados Unidos, que son más velocistas, ¿no? Pero se ha trabajado también mucho aquí, están usando mucho también su velocidad y han salido jóvenes con esas características.
Bueno, y muchos ángulos de picheo, ¿no? Porque, ligas mayores casi tú ves al pitcher siempre el mismo ángulo. Y el béisbol mexicano, tú ves que lo sacan de tres cuartos, lo sacan de lado, la pichada lo sacan a veces hasta por la submarina, el mismo pitcher. Y en ligas mayores, no, lo metes y es un pitcher que siempre, el Tyler Glasnow, no sé, de Tampa, tira por arriba en la cabeza casi, y todas son así, nunca cambia el ángulo. Y en México sí, cambian el ángulo continuamente.
Pues sí, por lo regular cuando son pitchers, por ejemplo, el caso de los zurdos que son de situaciones nada más y que entran a picharle a los pitchers zurdos, pues tratan de tirarles de lado para sacar los outs más fácil. Le buscan la forma de sacarte muchas veces. Ya cuando van para el béisbol de Estados Unidos, pues les cambian las posiciones de la forma de tirar, ¿no? Muchas veces para que tengas más velocidad también, que te ayude a tirar más velocidad, pero ha estado cambiando mucho eso también aquí en México.